Interaction was she was a silent auction contributor. This is important information to understand because it helps me understand who she is in terms of her role to us. So for example, I might want to know the different sources in which she's come to me in. I want to know that she was part of a group of volunteers. I also want to know that she first found out about us from an event, again, where she was the guest at one of our board members. So when you're pulling information in, think about the person's role that they're going to play with you. When you think about their storage, if you will, do you want someone front and center, or do you want someone to be kind of on the back burner until you have a better understanding of who they are? In addition to that, keep track of your sources, because you might recognize some repeat offenders, if you will. So if you see someone coming up more and more, even if it's at very transactional levels, it may be worth interacting with. The music going on.
Okay.
Huh?
There's a mute on the
phone. No, I like this. It's just being analytical. My last, actually, Amanda and I, our most recent roles at Blackbaud was in the Target Analytics Division. So both of us have a passion for data-driven fundraising because we've been able to see the unbelievable impact it can have on results. I only worked with Canadian organizations. Yes, a special place in my heart. And it was really different for me. So while some of my colleagues were going, yeah, let's do these wealth experiments, and let's do this, and like the most unbelievably personal things about individuals, you guys are like, no, we are going to give some privacy to the individuals that live in Canada. So it was a little different conversation than I would have with individuals. And here's what I would always kind of come away with. Yes, there is external information that statisticians can provide, that there is publicly, and that's really helpful. But where we were seeing the most impact was from right from your own Raiser's Edge database. Because you guys know your constituency base more than anyone. So specifically when it comes to Canadian organizations, I find this to be incredibly important. Take the time and go through and look for common trends. Does someone live in an affluent area? Has someone attended an event? Did you do some sort of wealth rating? Because these types of things can actually tell you what they have high affinity to do for you. So maybe it's a high affinity to make a major gift. However, you do not have a high affinity, you've got a low affinity to make a principal gift. And the cool thing about this, by using the data that's within your own database, it's not just about giving. You can actually understand who's most likely to attend this meal that I have coming up. Who's most likely to volunteer? Who's most likely to be an advocate for me on social media? You can come up with whatever you're looking for and use the data that you work so diligently in tracking to determine who best fits that picture. And finally, be responsive. Believe it or not, this is one of the areas that I see us sort of drop the ball most often. We work so hard, again, we track the data, we've scrubbed the database, we've kept our donors, you know, engaged, but we need to be responsive about what we've actually learned. So know what your major donor prospects respond to the most. Test, send out different appeals to understand what they're actually going to respond to. Once you do, assign those appeals, any specific packages, and then understand and measure your results too. Understand how they're performing. When we talk about segmentation, really kind of designing how we're communicating with the different segmentations of our constituency base, a lot of organizations rely on direct mail through a mail house, or they will outsource it because they just don't have the time to do it internally. That's okay, but where, again, we lose control is with the results. We're sort of relying on this external source to tell us who to talk to and how to talk to them when it's us internally that have the best knowledge of our constituents. So consider taking it in-house. Consider at least measuring the results of your direct mail campaigns, of your marketing efforts in-house.
Keep it going.
The other thing that I would recommend that you do is once you do create the segmentations, do some A/B testing and also understand what the cost of the segmentation is going to be. We're not afraid to invest in some pretty beautiful direct mail pieces or some very hands-on interactions, taking potential donors out to lunch. But create a formula, understand what's going to be the overall cost for a certain effort, and then project, what do I expect my results to be? Low response, what does low response look like? If it's low response, then what do I anticipate my results being? Medium response, high response? Understand before you actually invest if you are going to come out net positive on this. Sounds pretty straightforward, but you'd be surprised how few and far between I see people doing this. That being said, the future state of fundraising, I think that we all can agree on, it is a moving target. We are here to learn today, we're here to share ideas, but there's a reason why you have this group annually, and that's because fundraising is not a stagnant thing. We have to keep moving with our donors. If not, then there's just no way that we're going to be able to fulfill our missions. So keep that in mind. Collection of data. This is a big point right now. We are seeing, even within Blackbaud, as Brian was alluding to with the acquisitions, there are more and more best-of-breed solutions out there, and people are moving from one centralized database to focusing on these best-of-breed solutions. So rather than using Raiser's Edge or Raiser's Edge of NXT for everything, they're also going to incorporate, you know, Eventbrite or Volunteer Hub. And I think that Blackbaud is completely okay with that in some instances. You know, it's fine. Sometimes it just works better. But when we're moving from data collection to actual utilization for fundraising, we've got to be very careful because so much can get lost in translation that it really renders the data ineffective. So be very diligent about how you are treating information as it moves through that import or integration process. So let's just kind of go over the different things that Agent Tanich and I learned from our endeavors here. So first thing we're going to talk about is being prepared. So here are some of the ways that you can be prepared. Within your internal database, dedupe. I don't know any organization that's like, no, we're good, we don't have any duplicates. It's just a systemic issue. As Amanda mentioned, I used to work in data entry for the Cleveland Zoo way back when, and oh my gosh, there's so many ways to put in duplicates, especially with people's names changing, people's addresses changing, you're really at risk for that. So, well, as we know, moving into NXT, it's a per record cost. So let's try and make sure that we are minimizing our investment. The other thing too is I know I'm very engaged in a nonprofit locally in Charleston, South Carolina, and last year I got three pieces of direct mail. These really nice, thick, beautiful, glossy, you know, here's how we've been doing. And it was so frustrating to me because all I could think of, take these two, trade it and send it to someone else, or use that, you know, $6 or whatever that costs you to send those to me, and put it towards a program, put it towards turning the lights on. So it can be frustrating as well to have duplicates for those individuals. NCOA, I can't remember the most recent statistic that was like 200,000 individuals are moving every year, but that was a few years old, so it might be more than that now. But people are moving all the time. You don't want to just send out data that's never going to get received or going to get received by the wrong person. So keep doing NCOA updates through Canada Post. I know Blackbaud's got address finder for Canadian organizations. And then table standardization. This is something that we can talk a little bit more about offline, but making sure that you've got standards within your database, you're keeping up, you've archived old information, old way of tracking things that you actually don't need anymore. Be selective. Again, we talk about the fact that our donors or potential donors are incredibly selective of us, so we need to be just as selective as them. Follow a process. Establish a policies and procedures guide internally and follow it. It's really easy to go awry. There's a lot of turnover in nonprofits, so it's really easy to kind of forget that, but create a process and follow it. Make sure that everyone's on board, everyone has a vested interest. Speak your language. If you move to a new nonprofit or you have a department you didn't have before, don't assume that you're all speaking the same language. People might have different definitions of constituency codes, of attributes, of way of tracking things, of what's important. Every nonprofit has a little bit different nuance in the way that they're tracking things. Be expectant of that and be reflective of that. Make sure that everyone is on the same page. Ignore irrelevant data. I know it's really hard if you're working so hard to track all these different things to say, nah, I'm not actually going to manage that in the razor's edge. But as I said before, every piece of data should have a role. It should have a role in your fundraising. If you don't need it, then don't import it. Okay? That's okay. You're allowed to do that. You're allowed to turn away data if you're not going to actually use it to make a decision on something. There's some book that's out right now about your home. If it doesn't bring you joy, throw it away. I'm definitely don't follow that. But
you have seen your house.
Yeah. I'm a 5-year-old, okay? I would say kind of try to do that. You know, if it doesn't mean something to you, then maybe purge it, maybe archive it, maybe don't use it. Be organized. Okay, think of your razor's edge almost as a filing cabinet. We need to make sure that we've got individuals in the correct files. And it's okay also to make a copy of one of those individuals and put them in another file, just so we understand the sources. So I might have one file for here are my volunteers. I might have another file for here are my May 2017 event attendees or my runners if I'm doing peer-to-peer fundraising. Make sure that you're tracking the sources of origin for all these individuals. As I mentioned before, you want to look for these repeat offenders because while peer-to-peer fundraising and crowdfunding is hugely popular right now, it's incredibly, incredibly transactional. And what that's doing is giving nonprofits this false sense of security. Fundraising numbers are going up, but as I mentioned, the number of donors is going down. If Amanda does a 5K run and says, can you please donate for me? Yeah, absolutely. Now, is that organization ever going to hear from me again? I don't know, probably not. So it's not a good prediction of our future fundraising goals. Keep tabs on every person. Because if Amanda's organization that she's passionate about notices that I also attended an event as her guest, and I also went with her to volunteer for something, it may be worth engaging me as their own individual donor contributor. Finally, keep TBD suspects in a holding zone. Don't put them on trial just yet. And what I mean by that is, again, we want to be very, very cautious of every single person. If you are interviewing witnesses and you're not really sure of this witness, you know that they were there at the scene of the crime, for instance, but you don't know what they saw. You don't want to just throw them on the stand because they might tell you something incorrect. They might lead you down a certain path. So be very organized about your suspects or your constituents. And make sure that the ones that are at the forefront of your fundraising efforts, the ones that are appearing in your appeal selections, that are appearing in your queries and your reports, should be there. Those individuals that maybe you're not really sure what role they're going to play yet, that's okay. Hold on to them. Don't throw away that data. But maybe push it to the back burner. Do some e-marketing around that, just something low cost, while you sort of test the waters and see what type of affinity they have to the organization. Analytical. So as I mentioned, this is one of my favorite things to talk about, and I will keep myself brief here, but be analytical. Look for trends. Again, if you have an external data source, if you've done a target analytics project, if you've done, is Wealth Engine in Canada? Are they doing Canadian projects yet? No? Okay. It was like this here, so probably not. But there are a lot of different organizations that can give you some external input. That is awesome. What I'm saying here is use that as part of additional analysis that you do internally because you guys know your databases more than anyone. An external source is going to give you some intel that you might not have known before, which is excellent. But don't leave that as a silo and only rely on that. Use it in conjunction with all the other information that you're already tracking. Refresh your formulas. Things are changing. Things are changing quarterly. It's unbelievable how fast things are changing. Someone that might not have been able to give you a penny yesterday can give you, $100,000 next year. and vice versa. So make sure that you're not just assuming that the same sort of attributes that make up someone who is a potential sustainer giver are going to be the same as they were last year. Keep refreshing formulas, test it out, make sure those that are consistent sustainer givers keep coming up, ranking high in your different formulas. Don't ignore flight risks. When we're talking about analytical data, we're always thinking about, ooh, who are my possible major donors? Who are my possible sustainer givers, principal donors? I mean, there's so many exciting things to find out. Well, for every 100, according to FEP 2016 survey, for every 100 donors acquired, 99 lost. So it is worth your time, it is worth your effort to actually look through and find those individuals, be it donors or potential donors, that are flight risks. Who did you have that was giving every year that suddenly just dropped off? Again, people are incredibly expectant in terms of being talked to in a very personalized, individualized manner. So make sure that you are looking at the reverse, not just who can do something for me, but also who's done something for me that I want to be able to hold on to. As we all know, way, way, way cheaper to hold on to someone than it is to acquire a new donor. And then finally, be responsive. Establish hierarchies. Who here is doing RFM? Recency frequency monitoring, monetary segmentation? Okay, so it's a really neat thing. It's basically organizing and segmenting your database to understand who has given me money recently, who has given me money frequently, and who's given me a lot of money. So RFM is a really powerful way to be able to segment your database in terms of deciding how you're going to communicate with those individuals. But don't leave it at RFM. Again, come back to, you guys work so hard to track this data and to pull it into Razor's Edge. Use it. Come up with your hierarchies. Come up with hierarchies that mean something to you. Of your constituency codes, what's the most beneficial? Do you find that your supporters are the best constituency codes you have? And then maybe followed by volunteers, and then finally friends. Come up with hierarchies because you can create specific segmentation based on those hierarchies. A/B test. Don't just assume that you've got these great ideas and you're going to send out this letter and this mailing that you've always done and it's always responded well. Send out two different sets. See which one performs better. And then measure results. Again, just because something performed well last year does not mean that it's going to perform just as well this year. So what I would recommend is that you continue to do A/B testing, you continue to measure results. Okay. The whole goal behind this is your mission is possible. You just have to put in some work to get there. But what you guys are doing is among the greatest work that is done in the world. So continue it, keep in mind what your underlying mission is, and just be smart about it. And with that, Amanda and I wanted to take some questions on data intelligence and the state of the market. Thank you. You can clap. I'm pretty great.
Hospital Foundation, and I was doing an import, and what I love about Omatic is it says, oh, there's somebody in the database, you know, 93% chance it's the same person. I'm like, yes, use that record. And then, I'm just about to import, so I'll explain to you, it's the staff 50-50 lottery, and about one-third are already in there. And then I get the, I had quite a few error messages that I had to go through, and then I'm finally ready, I think I'm ready, to hit import because there's a deadline. Ian Mauer is over here. He was helping with this project. And Omatic says, oh, sorry, you've reached your 3,000 limit and you need to, so I needed to go in and turn off something. You probably know what I'm talking about. So what it is everybody who buys Omatic has like a free 3,000. We'll check in your database to see if they're there. If not, then you have to pay for this service. You know, this is like on a Friday, and you know, going out on a Sunday, and I'm having some East Coast time, so I had to go and disable. And not only is it duplicate checking, but there was also address checking. So I'm not even sure if we're paying for address checking or how the address checking was working, because we didn't have addresses. We only had emails for this group, so we didn't need any address checking. But I really like the fact that you can check for duplicates. So I think maybe, can you guys talk about this service versus the duplicate checking and the address checking?
Yeah, I'll speak to that.
Sure. So what you're talking about is what we call the Omatic Mail Service, or ODS. And what it is a little add-on to your import, and it looks at your addresses and names, and it standardizes them. So very similar to if you've done a change of address screening, and it'll standardize your address to Canada Post standards as it's coming in. That's what Omatic Data Service does. It says, hey, I know you've got this messy data from mobile giving, where someone wasn't capitalizing. We'll capitalize it. We'll also look for Mike, who's coming in. We'll look for Michael. If Robert's coming in, we're looking for Bob, Bobby, Robbie, and Rob. And we're considering those all to be equal matches, as if I saw Robert to Robert. What it doesn't do is it doesn't control whether Import-O-Matic looks for duplicates. On its own, without that optional data correction service, it still is a very robust, personalized duplicate search, and you have to go in and say, I do not want duplicates, or I do not want to check for duplicates. I'm going to force all these people into Razor's Edge. So there's a little bit difference between the two. So the important thing here to know is always, 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 once you have Import-O-Matic, there is no additional subscription for searching for duplicate records or searching by address or anything. That free data service trial period of 3,000 is for the additional correction, so that you don't have to correct your data prior to importing. So that's just a little tag on, but I'm glad you use it, and I'm glad you like
that. I'm glad I hit that 3,000 threshold.
Yeah.
It took a long time to get there.
And that's every year, yeah. So every year you get 3,000 rows for free of that correction service on the way in, but you don't have to use it. So a lot of people set up their own corrections. So especially with Canadian addresses, you format things a little bit differently than US addresses, and maybe you want to, you know, never put a punctuation at the end of something like a company tab, but a United States organization may want to. Those are all customizable things that you can set if you don't like how our automated service does it.
But just to kind of piggyback, just to be clear, yeah, the duplicate searching, looking for duplicates,
totally,
that's inherent of Import-O-Matic. It's basically that casting of a bit wider net with the names and the addresses. That's the additional 3,000 trials that you get every year. But we're still looking for duplicates every time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Sorry, what was that service called?
It's called the O-Matic Data Service, ODS.
I have lots of questions, so
Cold Blue, Jim Patterson, 5B. Cold Blue, Jim Patterson, 5B. Cold Blue, Jim Patterson, 5 Bravo.
My question's about merging. Somebody told me that when you bought O-Matic a long time ago, merging was included with the product, and now you're charging an additional service. So do you want to speak to when was it free? And
I think I know where the thought process is there. So as you're importing the existing records, we can merge the incoming data into that existing record or create a new one. That's included. That's always been included. That's included in moving forward. So if you're thinking about the external versus coming in, that's always there. If you're talking about two records in the Razor's Edge that merge together, it's where we do a duplicate search through the entire database to find duplicates, whether they're full constituents, non-constituents, or any variation of records. That has a trial period as well, where you get 100 free merges, 30 days, and actually it's always free to screen and find those people. It's right there in the Import-O-Matic, you just run that deep search. But that's never been, that product's Merge-O-Matic, it's never been provided as a free product in the past. So it's probably just confusion about the trial period.
The trial period.
Yeah.
Yeah, Import-O-Matic is amazing at duplicate prevention. Merge-O-Matic or duplicate management, that's just talking about already existing duplicates, either from before you had Import-O-Matic or from people hand entering the data.
So it's kind of your initial data cleanup. Mm-hmm. Or as Bailey said, dedup, dedup, dedup. And I think dedup.
Yeah. We're currently looking to do an NCOA cleanup on our database. And I've been looking at a variety of different organizations, and they're all promising pretty different things. But a lot of them, we're looking at some of the advanced services and other stuff they can give us beyond the basics, just clean up data, addresses. Some of them do seem to do some fun things for Canadians, like emails and telephone numbers especially. But they still charge kind of American-level prices for the American-level service. Do you know of any really great services we can get for just kind of just focusing Canadian updates beyond just the basic NCOA?
I'll turn it to the audience. I'm not sure if you guys, does anyone have any recommendations for that? And we can certainly come back and talk to our colleagues about it, but anyone have any good service that they've used?
I think most mail houses offer that national change of address because they're, if they're doing a big mail drop, then they're probably doing some cleanup themselves already. So you have to have a Canada Post. Somebody in your organization has to sign a contract with Canada Post about how long you've had a communication or a business relationship with the person you're trying to reach. So you can only run your national change of address from going back 24 months to the last time that person had any kind of interaction with you.
Yeah.
You can't run it back further than that, and you have to sign a contract with Canada Post so the third party can actually run your data as well.
We've got one of those, yeah, we do it using our mail sometimes. They do a pretty limited selection, and so we're looking I go to people directly, it seems their prices are really, really great compared to our mailhouse and not really doing that much for us. And the standardization is pretty handy as well. Plus, I really want to get a bunch of free telephone numbers and emails. But I'm trying to find, and there are so many out there, and they keep on offering different things, and services seem to vary pretty drastically. And even we've done a test with a few of them where we've sent a test data file, 1,000 of our records, some which we know are fake, and some which we know need. And what they're giving us back is very surprisingly, like a lot, given that we're using the same kind of post database. So I don't know if anyone's had experience in going directly to these people, but it's been a weird journey for me.
I think to speak to email addresses specifically, back when I worked at Blacklog, as Bailey said, we worked in target analytics and data management, and one of the things that SynClub included in that was things. was these type of finder cleanup services.
Yeah.
But the thing that I always noticed about the variations between your results that you get back with whether it's Blackbaud services or QAS or any other system or mailhouse is looking at their standards for what they consider a match to return to you. So in the case of email, I know for the U.S. email finder service for Blackbaud, they consider, okay, if we've reached that email address, you know, we'll send that back to you and let you take it from there. Some require opt-in where they send it and the person responds back and says, yes, this is me. So there's different levels of how they validate that information, and that may address your varying returns from them. So it's worth asking kind of what their standards and algorithms are for that, as much as they'll give it to you, because some of it's probably proprietary. But that may explain it, and that may guide your discussions with the different offerings.
Okay.
When I was interrupting you before,
yeah,
that was because just last time I was a target analyst, so a year and a half ago or so, addresses and phone numbers were available, email addresses were not. I don't know if that's changed, but just again, with privacy laws, it was available at least two target analytics.
Yeah.
So just wanted to throw that.
Well, we certainly, if we get the emails in, we can't use those for sending out appeals, because we don't have that permission yet.
Opt-in versus.
Yeah, but if they've opted in the past, then we don't have a good email for them, having sent one, it's really handy. And it's good as well, because we apparently, I don't know, two or three, I'm not really, really bored of the laws about this. Contact them with a particular question, not just a general appeal, which could be really useful for us.
Yeah, one of the first times I was here, we were talking about Castle. It was on the ring, and we're all like, what's it going to do? What other questions? Who here is doing direct mail in-house versus, I guess, let's start with that, versus a mail house would be the other alternative. Who's doing it in-house? Is anyone doing it in-house?
So what we're doing is we used to use an agency, and we brought that expertise in-house. So we do all of more of the analytics about how different packages from this year versus last year, different packages across. We have three main mailings, and so our packages are very similar, so we can do A/B testing and such, and we're running that all now in-house because we brought someone in who has that expertise, whereas before we used HMA. So we still use a mail house because our house file is about 25,000 when it goes out, and then the prospecting file can be really large as well, depending on how big we want it or what the budget is for that. So yeah, we're developing that in-house expertise on our annual giving team.
Awesome. Anyone else?
Yeah. Okay. We do very small direct mail campaigns in our organization, usually very targeted to people who have a history or affinity towards that particular offer, with great success. We don't have a lot of internal expertise, just the usual crowd, and don't really see a need to use an outside service yet.
Okay. What about analytics? Is anyone doing an analytic project in-house? So maybe has a statistician or is just doing some sort of trend analysis internally? Can you tell us a little bit about your experience and what you found?
I'm not actually the one who runs it. She's with David today. She does all of our analytics. We test everything. So if we can, we'll do an online test first, see how that performs with like Google AdWords as with Facebook. We'll do as much testing online, and then sometimes we'll actually bring that into our direct mail, which we do use an agency, but we test everything again. It's a bit of a slower test. We run 7 in-house mail fields and 2 acquisitions, and I think it's all except for 1 doesn't have a test in the year.
Okay.
Yeah. But so we have analytics offline and online as well.
Okay. Anyone else?
I'm surprised no one on my team is saying anything. You guys already heard about, we have a data warehouse.
Yeah.
We have 2 SQL programmers that help us run analytics, so we're there.
You're there.
We're doing it.
I asked about those 2 pieces, the analytics and the direct mail, because we get asked quite often, you know, what's in the future, what do we need to be paying attention to, and I would say those are our 2 biggest hot button, like, let's talk about these. It's questions that get the most, because we find that bringing the information, bringing sort of these formulas in-house, allowing you guys to get your hands dirty yourselves so you feel more confident in the data, you're going to actually use it. Target Analytics, I loved the things that they were doing, but if I found a project wasn't working and I dug into why, it was because you've got these gift officers who are like, I've got this fundraising goal that I need to meet. I'm not just going to blindly trust this external data to make my number. So I'm going to go with what I know. So it's a comfortability thing. So by pulling some of that in-house, you're able to sort of show your work, if you will. Here's how I came up with this formula. Here's how Robert Hernandez actually did score high, because he should have. Sort of build that confidence with your team, not only with the segmentation, but the analysis and sort of what's driving that as well. We just see, you know, most of us agree.
Okay.
You're
saying
that's right. That's very smart.
So I think you talked about a lot of the pros of bringing that analysis in-house, but one of the cons is, by not using HME to do all of our direct mail, we no longer have the competitive intelligence that they were offering us of how we were doing in comparison to other hospital foundations, because they used to actually provide us with that information, how we were tracking alongside our peers who are probably sitting right here in the room. I'm not sure how many of you use HME, but that's the one piece that we were paying more to use that external mail house, but we were actually getting something for that higher price tag, was that competitive commentary on how we're doing with tracking against other hospital foundations.
Well, there's that, and there's the additional data that they can sometimes append to your data to kind of enhance the results a little bit. Absolutely.
Yeah.
I think that there's a way, and I don't know what HMA offers in terms of packages, but if there's a way to do a little bit of both, so get those results and then internally add your data on a little bit, make it personal, that's definitely the best.
Can I ask if HME did that compared to it locally? So I'm guessing, you know, especially if it's Canada-wide, it's going to be huge variance in how you compare it to other foundations in other side of the country or even in the US, or was it just local folks?
Brian, do you recall?
Sorry.
It's the, sorry to put you on the spot. But before we brought our annual giving expertise in to do the analytics, when we were using HMA, were they giving us comparisons to other Canadian, or was it local BC, or was it other hospitals?
They were they weren't giving us so much direct comparisons. They were giving us, like, here's what other people are doing that you might want to try. So we didn't get any actual stats from them.
So it was more competitive intelligence about what they were planning on doing and what their path was.
Not even what they were planning on doing, just what they did was successful and whether we would want to do that. But we were mostly using them a little bit less for segmenting and more for the creative stuff. And they weren't actually giving us any, whenever we talk about analytics, for me I get confused between just sort of regular analysis and multivariate regression analysis. And so the predictive part of the piece they were not doing with us, we would typically have contracted out for that with, we didn't do it with Blackbaud, but looking at a couple of other providers in Toronto to do that separate piece, because we don't have that regression analysis expertise in-house. So analytics is a very loosely used term. And analytics can mean I look at a spreadsheet, or it can mean I use predictive analytics to figure out the people that I don't know anything about that might give for blend gift. Mm-hmm. So it's a wide spectrum.
And I think just for the sake of our discussion today, it would be the latter. We're talking about using data to predict behaviors.
Do you have the resources? So I've spent a lot of time looking online trying to compare, I work at a monthly giving campaign, trying to compare that to see where we are, to get a bit of a benchmark. But so much of the information online is US sources, and their fundraising, the way their numbers is slightly different from what we use. Is anyone aware of a really good Canadian focused stats that I can look at to get it across from where we're at? Anything like that? Finding US data is so easy, but Canadian data, it seems to be a nightmare.
I think it's quite expensive, but Environics, is that the right name?
Environics.
Yeah.
How do you spell that?
Environics, is that?
Yeah,
E-N-V-I-R-O-N-E-X. Yeah, they're actually more of a socio-demographic sort of clustering solution as opposed to comparative analytics between different fundraising programs. I would use the U.S. data just because, again, we always think we're quite different in Canada, but we're actually not that different. We just think we are. U.S. data, the U.S. economy, the people are more philanthropic as a percentage of their income, but the basic techniques and everything, in Canada, we have the British sort of sensibility of we're not proud of what we do as much as the Americans are, but we're actually just as sophisticated and just as capable. In fact, I would say we're even more capable because our populace is less philanthropic, so we have to try a lot harder. So that would be the Canadian.
The Target Analytics Division, I know, does something called donor centers, and I know there's a hospital group. I think there's a new hospital group that's done since I was there. But donor centers really kind of looks at trending across a specific vertical. I know that you can buy access to the results without actually being part of the team. They've got some parameters that they want you to fall in. Again, I'm not totally familiar with who they are at this point, but there was a Canadian higher education group, and I think there was a hospital foundation group, and that concludes the most brilliant thing that you'll ever hear. but definitely looking at donor centrics, there was a lot of really cool feedback that I learned there. Yeah.
Healthcare group for 1 year, so they have 1 year of data complete, and we're part of that group. So we've sent them now our second year's worth of data. And the interesting focus there is what Donor Centrics has asked us is specifically not the major gift group. They're looking more at the annual group because that's what we're hoping to get from them as well.
That and annual giving, because there's more data around it, it's easier to notice trends and analysis versus major donors. We wish we had tons and tons of major donors, but unfortunately, population isn't as large as annual donors. But yes, absolutely, that's the case.
And I worked on PCI to get some data that's based on SASCAN, the long survey that they did. Maybe 4 or 5 years ago now. And it's getting dated, but it was quite interesting at the time. And they had, for example, a thing about StatsCan divides all the neighborhoods into like 100 different segments. And I'm living in Asian up and coming, which is all of my neighbors are Asian up and comers, right? I'm like the one white person in the neighborhood. But it's quite interesting to sort of know, like, you know, what's the average house worth in the, you know, where it's all postal based, but it's quite interesting.
Yeah.
And then I took that, and as we would move, I would update it based on what I could see. The other people in that new postal code had been interested in, I'd update it myself based on what I sort of assumed their parameters had been in the StatsCan information.
Okay. Yeah, and certainly coming from the UK itself, there were major data maps on postal code incomes, and if you were color coded, you'd see the entire country, it was super easy to use. Here, I'm struggling to find that same kind of information. But KCI.
I don't know if you can get that directly, if you can like apply it from StatsCan. I don't think so. I think you have to get it from a third party.
Okay.
Canada Post provides for this one.
Like while reading basic post group?
For a paid service, though, not for
paid. Yeah, for paid service.
Still, that's right.
So I think what you're asking for is if you want to do analytics, you've got your razor's edge data, and you're looking to blend it with some big data sources that are Canadian specific. Is that sort of what you're asking?
Yeah, a little bit. Just to really get an idea, because we're trying to assess different programs we've got running, and whether our monthly giving is doing well or online giving. Online giving is a bit easier because there is a lot more information on that, I think. Mm-hmm. But certainly for our, you know, for our direct mail or for our monthly giving is what I'm focused on. Set, you know, looking at things like our retention or active donor giving, mm-hmm. all that kind of stuff. And there is information from the US and there is information from the UK. Canada seems to be slightly more effective. Yeah, I'm just looking for good, reliable data source. And if I can see the differences between, you know, Canadian giving and American giving in general, there is some information on that, but it's, you know, actually, better.
Maybe our friend from Blackbaud can
I was actually going to say, have you looked at the Luminate online transport report?
Yeah.
So it's, I mean, it doesn't break down the US in Canada, but it does break down by industry.
Yeah.
Yes, and it's kind of misleading because it says Luminate Online, and if you're not using Luminate Online, it's still really valuable data. So you can look at your monthly sustaining donors and see where you are, you're at the top, or you're at the median, or you're above, below,
yeah.
or you're in the top quadrant, and so forth. So I think that's really, really valuable, especially when you're looking at by industry.
Yeah, okay. I do like on the Luminate reports, which I read, but they've got all the different things here, you know, humanitarian ones and animal charities.
Mm-hmm.
And the Canadian charities is like talking of itself, just kind of.
Well, it's kind of interesting. I would make a point because I do work with the data that produces that. I connected the data with it. To see how much Canadian data we have. And that may be why we haven't broken it down, but if there's enough to really break it out from 2017 and 2016.
Okay.
Other questions? Comments? Suggestions?
What? when you were showing this information about Julia, I was like, is that a Kardashian fan?
Doesn't she look very Kardashian? What stock in it did you pull here?
I know.
I was looking for she was married.
Yes. You had mentioned about what table she sat at, and I was like, I've never thought of going through like the big galas and assigning relationships based on 2 years ago, you sat at a table with this person, maybe you know them socially. Like, why not put that in as a relationship? Everyone you sat with over time, and like build up natural partner relationships. I was like, oh, I might go back and try doing that. But then I also thought, in the duplicate checker, in more dramatic,
doesn't look at her breath, it just good information, does it?
I don't know about the algorithm behind it.
You can merge
information about the event if you're merging records. But in terms of looking through, I don't know if it's included in the
online. A guest record with an email and already in the database and the online linked it. That's a lot of more dramatic. I don't know if the tables are like that kind of they're considering non-considered records, probably not.
I understand what she's asking. Okay, so we've had a lot of turnover in our events team, and one of them said to me, she says, you know, I look at who attended last year and they're here again, but they don't have their own constituent records. So now we create constituent records for everyone who attends our events because then it's easier to do that link. But you're right, going back historically, if you have people who attend 3 golf tournaments and then they don't come for 2 years for whatever reason and then they start coming again, if those have never been full constituent records, then we don't have the history. So what Sandy's asking is if
it would matter if we did find them.
Yeah, I will have to, in the combination of list management and merge management, I'm kind of thinking both. What I'd like to do is look specifically back in my documentation and done on that. And get back to you. I know you know how to find me. So I want to look and see if event participants are included in our non-constituent search, because I know we do include non-constituents in our algorithms, but I just need to look specifically to that type. But I get it for you right there, and I'll get back to you.
So for those of you who are like, what are they talking about right now, there's a tool that Pomatic has called List Management and allows you to kind of pull in people or individuals as either full or non-constituents. So if I import Amanda Janet and it recognizes, hey, she's already in your Raiser's Edge database, great, it will associate her with that record. But if I pull in Bailey Bensley and this is the first interaction you've got with me, then it will keep me as a non-constituent. So I won't appear in any record searches, any queries, anything like that. I'm only living in this list management like hub in the back end of Raiser's Edge. So you can continue to, you know, assign action tracks and apply appeals, things like that. So you can cultivate them. But until either I make a gift or you read about me in the paper as being this unbelievably benevolent person and you want to promote me as a full constituent, I'm only living as a non-constituent within there. So you can attack,
depending on how aggressive you are. You can attack that prospect.
Event attendance as well in a non-constituent record. Right. Just can't track the registration fee.
Right.
Yeah. So what else? We've got like 7 minutes left in our time, so we'll be happy to answer or address any other questions.
Can you give us a little highlight about what you're doing this afternoon so people can decide which group they want to... The afternoon is more going to be discussion where I hope there's going to be more discussion, but it might be your presentation.
Now,
our goal is to have it more interactive.
Mm-hmm, sure. So basically, this is my opportunity to tell everyone how much better than Andrew Massawi I am.
Well, we're going to figure out who's in the big room and who's in the small room, yeah? So go ahead.
So I don't have a cool accent like Andrew does, but what we're going to be talking about this afternoon is the OMATIC connector between for OMATIC for Luminate Online. So I think a lot of you guys have used Luminate Online, and we know that there's the Relo connector, which is Blackbaud's version of the connector. So what we've done is sort of said, okay, if that's already there, if that's already there, let's not worry about that corner of the market. Let's focus on the other half. So those needs that are more flexible, more control, access to more data, choose which records are synced back and forth. So we have this connection, which basically uses Import-O-Matic as the engine, but it connects directly into your instance of Luminate Online, allowing you to push and pull records between the two systems at your home, whatever you'd like.
Great.
Okay?
I'll save my questions for that section.
Sure, absolutely. Well, thank you guys so much. Sorry about the amazing technology here. It was going to be so cool. I was going to rappel in.
She's going to come down and
it's going to be great. But what we will do, though, is we will PDF this and send it over so you can actually look at it without like blinking all over the place. But happy to address any questions. Thank you guys for having us.
So before we go on a break, I forgot to say... just if you're on the organizing committee, we actually have the newest member now brought her daughter. So we have somebody in the back of the room, and her name is Vivian, right?
Yes.
There she is.
Sarah's on the organizing committee, and she came here on her mat leave, and she brought Vivian. So we have a baby in the crowd. Aww. That's a first, and I'm so happy she's here. I also wanted Sandy to put up her hand, and Tracy. Yeah, Tracy right here. Tracy, Sandy, Sarah. So if you have any questions for the organizing committee, please approach us. We're happy. Let's see. And jobs. So we forgot to cover that before we launched in, but what jobs do we have, Brian? Or Ian?
Come replace me. I'm doing a master's program. So it's limiting online website development, so WordPress experience. Those are big ones. Yeah, Apple hardware support, iPads, MacBooks, all that kind of
stuff. And I'll be paying more than he's making.
So,
by at least 20%.
Maybe I went to the master's. Yeah, so if anybody wants to talk about the position, come over and let me know.
Yeah, go ahead.
We should have a bunch coming up from the house. So we have two, maybe more in management processing. And that's a general bit of everything that kind of specialists can get there. We have at least two, maybe more major.